Welcome to AETCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we'll be discussing a case of a young adult who presented to ER with complaints of fever. So sir, there was this 23-year-old young male who presented to our ER with complaints of 10 days history of fever along with chills and headache. Chills, basically he would complain of extreme cold, following which he'll feel really hot and then cold. So it was like intermittent chills and rigors along with fever and headache history since about 10 days. So in our initial 10-second assessment, patient was conscious, oriented, obeying to our commands. Primary survey wise, patient's airway was patent. There is no pooling of saliva, no excessive secretions, no hoarseness of voice noted. Breathing wise, patient had air entry to be bilaterally equal with a respiratory rate of 26 cycles per minute, maintaining saturation of 97% on room air. Air entry bilaterally was equal with no added sounds heard. Circulation wise, patient was tachycardic but with regular rhythm, and heart rate was 116 beats per minute with a blood pressure of 120/70, and all peripheral pulses were palpable. Disability wise, he had a full GCS score of E4, V5, M6, totaling up to 15/15, with pupils being 2.5 mm bilaterally reactive to light. No deficits as such seen. Then exposure wise, he was running a temperature of 102 degrees Fahrenheit along with blood sugar levels being 109 milligram per deciliter. So in our primary survey, all we could find was the patient was tachycardic and febrile. So at this point in time, we cannulated the patient and started the patient on paracetamol 1 gram. And adjuncts wise, we just took a VBG to check for any lactate levels. Otherwise, respiratory issues weren't there, so arterial blood gas wasn't warranted at this stage. He had no acid-based derangement, and lactate levels was 2.1 mil. If at all patient has respiratory distress, or because of tachypnea itself, patient can have respiratory alkalosis. But if the patient has an underlying sepsis, then if end organ damage is there, then hypovolemia, dehydration, anything can cause metabolic acidosis.
One thing you need to remember is that the patient may not go into respiratory alkalosis per se. Okay. You have to, this is a situation where even if the normal pH is normal, an absolute value of your PCO2 will be relevant. Because the body will be compensating initially. Okay, you might get a pH of 7.4-ish, PCO2 might be in the 30s. And the bicarb will also be low, compensating for that.
Okay, sir. So ECG just showed sinus tachycardia, no acute STT changes were noted. So then moving on to our sample history, this patient was...
No, at this point, what are the differentials you're going to consider?
Sir, is this...
Male with fever, with headache and body pain, that's all.
That's it, sir. So that could be one viral illness which could be most common. Apart from that, the patient can have any of the infectious diseases like dengue fever or leptospirosis, malaria, LRTI, UTI, any of fever causes can present like this. So fever, we are left, there will be a lot of differential diagnosis, chikungunya. So basically only after investigations and further examination will have an idea, we can narrow it down. So otherwise it's just fever history with a lot of differentials.
Basically infectious pathology was
infectious, suspicion. Yeah. So in sample history wise, patient was no known comorbidity, not alcoholic, wouldn't consume tobacco. Then his event, basically he had high grade fever but fluctuating through the day along with chills and rigors, wherein he would feel exceptionally hot and exceptionally cold. Along with this, he had associated myalgia with headache, which was persistent pretty much.
Yeah. Sir? Was there any pattern to the fever?
Variation, intermittent fever. So along with this, the chills and rigors, and then associated headache, myalgia was there, but there was no rashes noted. No similar history in the family was there, and then apart from fever and headache, he didn't really seem to have anything much. No respiratory distress, no chest pain, vomiting, no GI symptoms. Then no chest pain, no altered consciousness. Then what else do you ask? Basically, all the other negative, positive history was only this much that we could derive. So with this, but when he went to a local hospital, he was getting evaluated and symptomatically managed. But at that point in time, his dengue NS1 combination, which was done within 3 days of his onset of fever, turned out to be negative. But malaria antigen was positive. So we had a definition, we knew that it was a definitive case of malaria, but we didn't have much of information on it. So we had to redo the tests. So when we reran the test, we found out that the patient was positive for falciparum antigen. But the gold standard diagnosis would be a blood smear, thin and thick. In thick smear, we get to know a quantitative diagnosis that this is malaria. But if it is thin smear, we can get to know the qualitative, basically what species of malaria patient has been infected with. So for us at present, the diagnosis we had was an uncomplicated falciparum malaria. So with this, we had to go because there's a criteria definition to be called as a severe malaria. So that'll include a altered sensorium with a GCS of less than 11. Our patient should have an high anion gap metabolic acidosis with lactate at least more than 5. Our patient should have severe anemia secondary to massive intravascular hemolysis, and patient can have recurrent hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia will be because of impaired gluconeogenesis, or quinine itself can induce hyperinsulinemia once we start the treatment. Then so apart from more causes, hepatic impairment, basically reserve of glucose gets depleted, so patient goes into hypoglycemia.
More consumption of sugar by the
parasites. So hypoglycemia, then anemia, then end organ damage. That is acute renal failure. That is called as a black water fever, where patient also has hemoglobinurias, which is why patient will present with dark colored urine. And along with this, acute liver failure can happen. But since patient did not elicit any of these signs, cerebral malaria. But all these are notoriously caused by falciparum. Cerebral malaria presents with one encephalopathy or seizures history. Then patient can have deficits. So cerebral edema can be there. So all this can cause cerebral malaria. But this patient did not have. So Alzheimer's fever.
Since you touched upon cerebral malaria, what's one of the key things in diagnosis of cerebral malaria?
One, increased opening pressure will be there, and patient can have retinopathy.
Retinal hemorrhages.
Retinopathy in terms of retinal hemorrhages will be there in cerebral malaria. Patient presents with seizure history, with the focal deficits. So, but all these, like I said, will be attributed to falciparum.
Complicated. Shock
you told? Circulatory collapse. Hemodynamic instability will be there. Circulatory collapse can cause. Then Alzheimer's malaria. Coagulopathy.
ARDS.
So, pretty much all the organs can be affected in complicated falciparum malaria. So, but since this patient did not have any of this, we termed it as an uncomplicated falciparum malaria. So treatment itself varies for both severe and for uncomplicated, and also depending upon the species and the geographical areas. If malaria is indigenous, then again another question raises whether it is chloroquine resistant or not resistant. But now the newer guidelines prefer for artesunate and artemether preparations. So chloroquine is not generally preferred as a first line in the newer guidelines. So when we talk about the regimens of falciparum malaria, it depends on whether it is complicated or uncomplicated, but preferable is an oral route unless patient cannot tolerate oral therapy. So in that case, it will be IV preparations, and if it's a complicated malaria, then we will give injection artesunate in a dosage of 2.4 milligram per kg, which is given as a start dose, and following which 12-hour interval, like a start, then after 12 hours, then the next will be 24 hours from the first dose. And after a 24 hour of parenteral therapy, we prefer to switch the patient to an oral route because it's a go-to medication. So if we switch, then we give generally in combination. So there is combination of antimethor with lumefantrine, or with artesunate and advoquan. whatever. Then artesunate with mefloquine. So dosages again, they vary. If it is then it will be 200 mg with 540 mg of atoquine, and the other one will be again 200 mg with 540 of mefloquine. This would be the dosages for the other treatment. And if it is
quinine, so decide the initial dose is going to be a parasite load, right? Parasite load.
4 to 10% would be considered as, at least more than 4% will be considered as significant. But in terms of parasitemia, it will be more than 5,000 parasites per microliter of blood. Only then we consider it significant. And also depending upon the location, complicated, non-complicated, all of that. So if you're going with artemether and lumefantrine, then it will be 80 mg with 120 mg combination. So, but then again, that also depends upon the body weight. So this would be the oral regimens. And injection-wise, severe malaria, like I mentioned, 2.4 mg per kg. And if it is chloroquine preparations, then it will be 600 mg. And if at all patient has Plasmodium vivax or ovale, then chances of hypnozoite recurrent infections, relapses are high. So in that case, we add a primoquine, because in this cycle that there will be hypnozoites, so they become dormant in the liver, following which they get into the bloodstream, causing relapse of the infection.
What can be given to prevent that?
Primoquine. Primoquine for 14 days, on 14th day. So this is the this is how we're going to treat an uncomplicated. For complicated, along with injection of anti-malarial agent, we have to treat specifically whichever complication is there, for cerebral malaria or black water fever. So that would be in parallel with it, we'll have to treat it, because the chances of mortality within 24 hours of infection is really high if at all patient blows, or rather gets into falciparum malaria. But this patient did not show any features of it. And chances of recurrent infection is high, because there are certain groups of people wherein this there's a higher risk, like immunocompromised people, then the ones with retroviral infections, or travelers, then migrant workers, kids, especially children less than 5 years, pregnant women. So in these cases, we'll have to counsel them for not just about prevention of malaria, but also when they are, as for chemoprophylaxis, basically whenever they're traveling, they'll have to take medications, anti-malarial agents, in order to prevent the infection. So in that, there are again...
Chemoprophylaxis for a healthy person also?
Yes, sir. If he's going for a malarial indigenous areas. So in that, again, you'll have regimens for chemoprophylaxis. We can either go with mefloquine or chloroquine or just doxycycline, or a combination of atropine with progranulin. If you're going with that combination, it is a daily dose that we will start 1 to 2 days before the travel. And we, at the same time, we advise the patient to take the medications, 4 tablets of it. So same time every day, and after returning from the area, 7 days following this. If you're going for chloroquine, then it will be once a week that we start 1 to 2 weeks before the travel, and we continue 4 weeks after the travel also. Doxycycline, it's not BD dose, it will be OD dose. Same 1 to 2 weeks before to after 1 month from returning. So this would be chemoprophylaxis. And apart from that, the other vector control preventive strategies has to be adopted.
Along with malarial, severe malarial infection, do you start any other antibiotics?
To prevent secondary infection.
Okay, but other than
doxycycline, then tetracycline. Because of say for secondary bacterial infections, huh?
Gram-negative infections are common with the falciparum infection. So, better to cover gram-negative infections with antibiotics. What are the criteria for transfusion in malaria?
hemoglobin less than 7, basically the patient has massive, because of intravascular hemolysis and also extravascular, patient will have splenomegaly. So spleno, in fact, splenic rupture can also cause massive hypovolemia and death. So these would be the two things, one because of intravascular hemolysis and one because of splenomegaly, patient can end up with hypovolemia. So in that case, if I think if hemoglobin is less than 7, we transfuse. Yes.
Far as the hemolysis goes, so according to the peripherosmia hemolysis gradient, you have to transfuse the patient.
Mm.
Then what are the other supportive medications you will start for the patient?
Folic acid.
For
hemolysis, folic acid.
You have to supplement folic acid as well as iron for the patient. Okay. Stores will be depleted as soon as your treatment starts. Then what other monitoring should be done for the patient?
One, the patient is on a high risk for a circulatory collapse. So patient's blood pressure along with heart rate has to be monitored. Then chances of non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema in terms of ARDS is high. So patient's saturation, breathing, work of breathing, all that has to be kept in mind.
How basically. Do you diagnose ARDS?
ARDS, again, there's a criteria for it. It's called as a Berlin's criteria.
Mm-hmm.
So in that, the PaO2 with FiO2 ratio has to be more than 100.
Less than 100. So, initial management, if
you are suspecting ARDS? Then that again would be a positive pressure ventilation with low tidal volume and...
Just get this thing out of your mind that all ARDS needs to be on ventilator.
Okay. Then basically positive pressure ventilation.
Positive pressure ventilation. Always current even Berlin criteria, Berlin ARDS management tells that mild ARDS, that is 300 to 200, you can manage with BiPAP.
Mm.
BiPAP is the management recommendation rather than invasive. But less than 200, more right to severe, you have to put on ventilator.
Yes.
And definitely for mild, there is role of HFNC.
Mm-hmm.
High flow nasal cannula.
Mm. What else? What is the role of dialysis?
Dialysis. Again, if the patient goes into acute renal failure, black water fever, and there is a complete renal shutdown, then we go with dialysis. But so,
continuous urinary output monitoring.
Monitoring.
And acidosis.
Acidosis, lactate levels, clearance, creatinine clearance.
Like earlier, we discussed something which needs to be monitored. Sugars, blood sugar levels.
Because hypoglycemia itself, per se, is a very bad prognostic
indicator.
Patient with malaria going into
recurrent
hypoglycemia is a bad prognosis.
Recurrent
hypoglycemia,
how will you manage?
Frequent blood sugar monitoring. And if the patient is confused, if the patient is awake, conscious, food.
Okay, not like that. Patient is recurrently going into hypoglycemia. You have given 25% dextrose. What else can you give?
Glucagon. 2 mg we give. Glucagon. Subcutaneous. That's it, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.